In the last video, we explored what conditions are like on a tidally locked planet, also called eyeball planet, circling an M-type red dwarf star.
Now we'd like to explore how life might evolve on such a planet, and how life would behave in such a fascinating place, and how would an intelligent civilization behave on such a world. Well, let's try letting the imagination run loose here.
You know, it's funny that we think of eyeball planets as strange and bizarre. But actually, the funny thing is that we are the ones that are strange and bizarre. Since such planets are the norm, because 76.45% of all stars are M-type red dwarf stars, we are really the oddballs. But still, for us, creatures that have evolved on a world that always rotates, that has seasons, changing climate, changing weather, basically constant change all the time, the notion of a planet where things stay the same is absolutely alien to us and therefore so fascinating.
But could life evolve on such a planet? I mean, why not? Where there are moderate temperatures and oceans, there will be life. We have seen it here on Earth. Even though Earth was a really brutal and hostile place 4.5 billion years ago, life started immediately after Earth cooled off. Like, immediately. Already 4.2 billion years ago, we had the first bacterial colonies. Why? Because oceans and moderate temperatures allowed for it. The atmosphere back then was almost completely CO2. Oxygen was not abundant yet. The building blocks of life are everywhere on meteorites. We found amino acids, sugar molecules, and lately, there is even research suggesting that simple proteins are present on meteorites throughout the galaxy and thus also in other galaxies in the entire universe. So the building blocks of life are really everywhere, and they just need the right planet with the right conditions to kickstart life. And since tidally locked planets are the most abundant type of planet, as we said before, it might really be that life on tidally locked planets is actually the most prevalent form of life. There are tens of billions of rocky tidally locked planets in the habitable zones in our galaxy alone.
Okay, so last episode we've established an example eyeball planet that is in the habitable zone of the parent M-type star, a star that is not too active. The planet has a magnetic field, which in fact can happen on such a planet due to tidal heating from the parent star, as researchers found. Then the planet has the right amount of CO2 for a temperate climate and also gets the right amount of stellar flux as to be not too hot and not too cold. It is therefore located in the habitable zone. Also, the atmosphere will need to be thick enough to allow for sufficient thermal heat transfer from the day side to the night side. A moon would be beneficial because the tides will help life to transition from the oceans to the land, as it also happened on Earth. You might think that these conditions are rare, but remember that there will still be hundreds of millions of such planets in our galaxy because of the sheer abundance of these worlds. Last time we established that such a planet would have black rainforests at the substellar region surrounded by a ring of deserts. Then around that, we would have the temperate region towards the terminator with huge rivers from the meltwater of the ice on the internal night side. Strong perpetual winds would blow here from the night side to the day side, and we would see a never-ending sunset or sunrise.
We have already mentioned that plant life would be extremely different on an eyeball planet. Tree leaves would be black, since light from the parent star is shifted so much towards the red end of the visible light spectrum. And the animal creatures here would also be very alien to us. We can assume the planet to be similar to Earth in mass, maybe a bit more or a bit less massive. Super Earths might also allow for favorable life conditions, but the much higher gravity will of course have an impact on the bone and muscle structure of life, making land creatures a lot more sturdy and stronger, and of course not very tall. If the gravity is similar to Earth gravity, then the creatures on this planet might be more recognizable. Still very alien, but taller than on super Earth planets. Planets with a lower gravity than Earth might allow for extremely thin and slender looking beings. Let's assume that we have a gravity condition that is similar to here on Earth. Then we think that on such planets, we would see a great variety of air creatures. Since the winds would be perpetual and unchanging, life might adapt much better to these unchanging wind conditions. We might see giant air predators and large floating creatures that just get carried along with the winds.
They might float upwards and be carried to the temperate region, employing some form of variable buoyancy. And then they might descend back down towards the surface and get carried back again towards the substellar point with the winds near the surface that always blow towards that direction. In the seas, we might see very large creatures develop, since ocean currents and water temperatures would also not change over the course of billions of years. We might see creatures that are a lot larger than on Earth, since they would have had a lot more time to develop and would not have had to adapt so often to ever-changing conditions as on Earth. This would also apply on land, if the radiation from the parent star is not so high, because the planet offers protection by means of a magnetic field. The mutation rate would also not be extremely high. And since conditions would be constant, evolution might not be quite as dynamic as on Earth. However, of course, a higher stellar radiation could change this and allow for a much higher mutation rate, thus leading actually to a very dynamic evolution, despite the constant conditions. Would creatures on such planets even sleep? Would sleep develop in biological organisms on such a planet, or would biological systems find other ways of regeneration and of reorganizing memory? After all, sleep patterns are very much linked to Earth's rotation, so who knows? Let's assume that an intelligent species would develop on such a planet. And time would not be an issue here, since M-type red dwarf stars live on average 1,000 times longer than the Sun, trillions of years. So in the future of the universe, evolution here will have plenty of time to create all possible life forms. These beings would see the universe very differently from us, since they would probably develop on the day side, because the night side would be on average below the freezing point of water, as we've established the last time. These creatures would not know stars. They would only know eternal day. This would have a profound impact on their view of the universe. The passage of time, their whole concept of time, would also be very different. Since nothing changes for them, no seasons, no day and night cycle, the concept of time for them might be more subtle. They would see the other planets of their star system, or if their planet has one or more moons, then they would see these objects change in the sky. But these would be the only things that change. Thus, they might develop a very different calendar system. They also would not get the feeling that they are the center of the universe.
On Earth, humanity lives for the longest time under the illusion that everything revolves around Earth. The sun, the moon, the stars, everything revolves around us. Some people sadly still live under this illusion. Of course, it was later found that this is only an apparent effect arising from the rotation of Earth. But on our eyeball planet, the intelligent beings would quickly find out that the other planets of their star system are circling their parent star. Therefore, their understanding of astronomy might develop a lot faster, and in turn also their ability to develop machines in order to better study the skies.
What gods would they worship? Since the central star would appear quite huge in the sky, it might play a central role in their religious views. Like Subutai in Conan the Barbarian, they might probably worship the god of the four winds. Winds will play a central role for them, and of course also the dark side. A very strong dualism might develop between light and dark side, like yin and yang. Some daring members of these beings would certainly be interested to find what lies on the dark side. They would venture ever deeper into the dark regions. They would certainly tell myths and legends about what terrors and creatures are lurking in the eternally dark regions. They would find an unchanging starlit sky and cold climate. Would some be outcast to the dark side? Would the most severe form of punishment for a crime be to be exiled to the dark side? We might thus even see two societies develop on some worlds, where darksiders and lightsiders might develop, each species adapted to their own environment. Many different tribes or nations might develop that each live in different climate and light conditions.
But winds would play a pivotal role, not only for their religious cults, but the never-ending winds might incentivize them to build machines that harness the power of these eternal winds. They might completely skip the use of fossil fuels, because the wind would allow for a much more efficient use of energy. Huge wind fields might be developed quite early on. Huge airships will be developed, because the never-changing winds on these planets are extremely predictable. Remember that unlike here on Earth, the winds on an eyeball planet never change. Air travel routes from city to city, and if they would even develop such a thing as cities, would be the norm, and would be developed surprisingly early. And if they are social creatures like us and develop cities, these cities will look totally different from ours. They might prefer building flat structures, protected from the wind, maybe in the river canyons of the huge river systems near the terminator. Huge windmills will rise up skywards, always rotating, never standing still, yielding constant power. If the planet has a moon, they would soon start a space program. But even without a moon, since the other planets of their star system would be so near, they could send probes to all planets of their star system really much faster and much more easily than in our case. Take the TRAPPIST-1 system, for example. The whole system is so small that it's even dwarfed by the orbit of Mercury around the Sun. That's how small these star systems actually are. So they would have it much easier to settle on other planets, as they all would be so close to their own home planet. The intelligent beings there could build bases on other planets much faster. If these other planets would offer good conditions, the civilizations there could soon live on quite a few worlds. In the TRAPPIST system, for example, a civilization that would hypothetically have developed on TRAPPIST-1e could easily establish colonies on TRAPPIST-1c, d, and f. The other planets would be either too cold or too hot. And for them, a voyage to these planets would be like when we travel to the moon. This would allow for very interconnected colonies. These planets could have established cities and infrastructure much faster than in our case, for example, on Mars. We need months of travel time to get to Mars, but they would only need days to get from one planet to the next, even with chemical propulsion. They would have quickly colonized their entire star system. And what then? Then, interstellar travel might already be the next step, since there wouldn't be any more goals for them in their own star system. While humanity will still have plenty to do in the solar system for hundreds of years, since it's so huge and the planets are so far apart, they might already try to develop interstellar flight much earlier. Therefore, a civilization from an eyeball planet might master interstellar travel much faster than us. The chances are thus quite high that the first interstellar civilization we will discover will come from an eyeball planet.
And as always, we'd like to thank all the people that help us with this channel, especially over on Discord. This is the famous Sabolch Yare, Michael Root, Jay King, Stefan van der Feest,
Another Space Nut, Framrick, Miko, Rich LV.
Then the guy who always changes his names, MLLT, Warhawk, Lucky Green, and Centauri Sparrow. Thanks a lot, guys. We really appreciate your help.
So then, thanks for watching the JI Space Report. And I would say, on to the future.